America's Irish had come to these shores to escape a great famine. Now in April 1863, they fought to show their loyalty to their adopted countries, North and South. From the Army of the Potomac's famous Irish Brigade to Lee's legendary Louisiana Tigers, the Irish would add their own special chapter to the saga of the Civil War's greatest battle.
The many faces of America were well represented in her most tragic war. Scandinavians from the timber of Michigan, French Acadians from the bayous of the Gulf Coast, Pennsylvania Germans and Smoky Mountain Scots. Each ethnic group stood and fought for the cause they believed in. But no group displayed greater courage and tenacity in battle than America's immigrant Irish. And nowhere was the heroism of the Irish, both North and South, better displayed than on the fields of the Civil War's greatest struggle, Gettysburg. In late May 1863, Robert E. Lee had reason to be very happy with himself and the army he commanded. In less than a year, he had outfought all four Union commanders who had faced him. His army had often successfully held off an enemy twice its size. In December, his troops had badly beaten the Army of the Potomac on the heights above Fredericksburg. After his brilliant victory at Chancellorsville earlier in the month, it was clear that Bobby Lee and his great Army of Northern Virginia were winning the Civil War in the East. Now, Lee had a plan which might at last bring the war to a successful conclusion for the South. Lee would take his battle-hardened legion and move across the Potomac River. Once in Pennsylvania, he would force the Army of the Potomac to fight him on ground of his own choosing. He would let Lincoln worry for a change about the possibility of this gray-clad horde pounding on the gates of Washington itself.
General Lee decides to transfer the war to the north, across the Potomac River into Maryland and Pennsylvania, to relieve pressure on the Confederates out in the Mississippi Valley, where General Grant has crossed the Mississippi River.
In the past 2 years of war, no part of Lee's army had done more to distinguish themselves than the regiments of immigrant Irish. Most were from Louisiana, but other Irish units came from Georgia and South Carolina. All had gained reputations for bravery and aggressiveness in battles beginning at First Manassas. Now, Lee's Irish joined their comrades and re-entered the Union. One of the members of the heavily Irish Louisiana regiment said of crossing the Pennsylvania state line,
"We shook the Maryland dust off our feet and marched into the Union to the tune of Dixie."
Behind them in Maryland were other Irish wearing blue who had also left the same counties of Erin to seek a new life in America. Unquestionably, the most famous Irish unit in the North was a brigade now attached to General Winfield Scott Hancock's 2nd Corps and known throughout the Army as simply the Irish Brigade. Made up of regiments from Philadelphia, Boston, and New York City, the Irish Brigade had earned a reputation for ferocity and fearlessness in every battle they had fought in. Colonel Patrick Kelly was now the commander of the 5 regiments of the Irish Brigade. Kelly was a native of County Galway who escaped the famine for America in 1850. Quiet, soft-spoken, and much liked by the men, Kelly was 42 in the summer of 1863. During the hot days of June, the Irish had slowly tramped the dusty roads with the rest of the Federals trying to keep up with Lee's army. On June 27th, the green flags of the Irish Brigade had crossed the Potomac River and the men camped at Frederick, Maryland. They could not know that the Army of Northern Virginia was now safely across the Potomac and on northern soil. The first elements of the invasion had worked perfectly, but 2 events now conspired to spoil Lee's best-laid plans. On June 28th, Lincoln replaced Joe Hooker as commander of the Army of the Potomac with George Gordon Meade. Meade had a quick temper and wasn't loved by his troops as some had loved Hooker. But Meade was unlike Hooker in another way. He wasn't intimidated by Robert E. Lee. The other event which would frustrate Lee's plan was his loss of the eyes of his army, the dashing horsemen of Jeb Stuart's cavalry. Stuart had started another of his legendary rides around the Yankee army, but found himself blocked from returning to assist Lee. Lacking Stuart's reports, Lee was forced to move into Pennsylvania without knowing the exact whereabouts of the Union forces. But on July 1st, he found them. Troops of A.P. Hill's Corps were surprised by Buford's Union cavalry at a crossroads named Gettysburg. Soon, over 150,000 men would converge on this spot. They did not know that this chance encounter would produce the greatest battle of the war. For most of the Irish who had found their way to this quiet Pennsylvania town, the journey had begun in their native Ireland with an obscure disease which killed potatoes. In September of 1845, a potato fungus called Phytophthora infestans arrived in Ireland. It was an unknown plague that could overnight turn a field of ripe potatoes into a reeking, rotting mass of garbage. The Great Irish Potato Famine caused by the fungus would not only radically change the physical and cultural life of Ireland, it would change the ethnic face of the United States as well. Potatoes accounted for 60 to 80% of the diet of the rural poor. The loss of even one crop was a disaster. In 5 years, Western and Southern Ireland would lose every potato crop but one. The results of the famine were dramatic and immediate. Between 1845 and 1850, life in Ireland became a living hell. Entire villages disappeared from starvation and disease. Over 1 million Irish would die from what came to be called the Great Hunger. One English reporter witnessing an Irish cottage described it as
the dying, the living, and the dead lying indiscriminately upon the same floor, without anything between them and the cold earth save a few miserable rags upon them.
Emigration from Ireland swelled immediately. By the thousands, the Irish took to the roads and headed for seaports. The overwhelming majority of famine immigrants wanted passage to America. In 1847, 30,000 Irish arrived in Boston. Between 1845 and 1855, 1 million Irish, one-eighth the pre-famine population of the country, would land in New York.
The land had just betrayed them pretty badly in Ireland in terms of the potato blight, so most of them had washed their hands of it. And they stayed in the urban areas, and of course they had very little money, so they lived in the poorest areas of the city, and they took the most menial jobs. They did things like cleaning the streets, longshoremen duty, day laborers, ditch diggers. Sometimes the women were lucky and got jobs as domestic servants.
By far the most famine immigrants arrived in the north, but many went south as well and took similar jobs. Irish had been coming to America since earliest colonial days, but the vast bulk of these had been Protestants from the north. Most had some skills and even a little money. Now the hordes of destitute and perhaps as important, Catholic Irish arriving in America soon provoked a strong backlash of bigotry and prejudice.
In 1850, when many of these famine Irish were arriving, they were despised. And in fact, the Irish were often considered an entirely separate race, not even white. That was the way the English separated themselves from the Irish. And their religion was considered not only inferior, but one that bound them to the Pope and made them unable to think on their own. So they naturally grouped together and found solace in each other and in their church and in their faith.
Irishmen quickly joined local militias. These military units served as social organizations in which Irish could be with other Irish, but they also gave outlet to other emotions. Many immigrants were members of the Fenian Brotherhood, secret Irish revolutionaries who wanted to avenge the famine and drive the English out of Ireland. The most famous of these militias was the 69th New York, led by a passionate Fenian named Michael Corcoran. This patriot was so loyal to Ireland that when the Prince of Wales visited America in 1860, Corcoran refused to parade the 69th in his honor. Corcoran was court-martialed for an action many believed confirmed Irish disloyalty to the Union. But before he could be discharged, that Union fell apart. As Southern cannonballs sailed across Charleston Harbor to smash Fort Sumter in April 1861, America slid toward the abyss of a national catastrophe. Neither North nor South was remotely ready for a war. Lincoln called for 75,000 men to voluntarily enlist for 90 days. Most would come from already organized state militias. Confederate President Jefferson Davis also needed to create an army. The Irish of the South were among the first to rally to the Stars and Bars. It was the more recent arrivals of famine Irish that provided most Confederate Irish recruits, workers from the cotton docks of Savannah or Charleston, wharf rats from the waterfront of New Orleans. These were men already struggling to survive on the most meager wages. For most, the possibility of millions of freed slaves on the job market represented a threat to their subsistence, for which they were willing to give their lives. Enlistment rolls show that over half the foreign-born troops enlisting in Louisiana units were Irish. The Calhoun Guards of the 6th Louisiana Volunteers were 90% Irish. Over 70% of Company B of the same brigade was Irish-born.
They believed that they were fighting for the independence of the Confederacy. They called it the Second War of Independence. In many cases, they looked at the plight of the Confederacy much like they look at the plight of Ireland vis-a-vis Great Britain.
So yes, they are Irish units in the South, perhaps not as well known, but just as loyal to the Confederate cause, just as colorful, and just as terrible fighters.
But Irish enlistment in the South totaled only about 20,000, a small portion of the Irish who would fight for the federal cause. Almost as soon as Lincoln's call went forth, Northern Irish stepped forward to protect the Union that most felt had saved them from the sad fate of the famine.
When Lincoln made his initial call for volunteers after Fort Sumter, he called for people to protect Washington, D.C. and the 69th State Militia in New York City, which was predominantly Irish, was very anxious to do that.
Over 150,000 Irish would eventually fight for the North. After Sumter, an Irish-American newspaper proclaimed,
"The Union flag shall never be trailed in the dust if Irish-American hearts and heads can keep it gloriously aloft."
But simple loyalty alone was not the only reason Irish lads were ready to leave for war. Having endured great prejudice and hatred, many Irish saw the war as a chance to change America's image of them.
I think that the Irish were interested in joining the Union Army and did so so rapidly and quickly after the war started for several reasons. One was that it was a sense of adventure, which is always there. The other was a sense that the Irish could somehow prove themselves as good Americans through this service, and that the Americans would truly see what good fighters they were, and they were proud of that history. And so they were anxious to fight for a good cause in the United States with their own American Irish Brigade, and hopefully convince Americans that they should be treated better in this country.
After the war's first battle at Bull Run, state militias in the North were absorbed into a federal force. The 69th New York Militia became only one regiment in a new brigade. Composed almost exclusively of Irishmen from New York, Boston, and Philadelphia, the Irish Brigade would become one of the most famous units to fight on either side during the war. At Antietam in September of 1862, the Irish Brigade fought with reckless courage in the hell of the sunken road. Over 500 of the brigade's 1,500 men fell as casualties. At Fredericksburg in the winter of 1862, the Irish Brigade was given the impossible assignment of storming Marie's Heights. Half the Irish who made the charge did not come back.
It was a very difficult battle, to say the least, but they earned an incredible reputation, not only in the Union Army, but from the Confederate officers, who often said things like, there's the green flags again, or my God, they're the green flags. They didn't want to see the green flags. In fact, the only time Stonewall Jackson is on record as having cursed, to use a curse, was when he saw the Irish Brigade's green flag.
Southern Irish were also earning a fearsome reputation during those first 2 years of the war. They had thrown back the Union onslaught at First Manassas and become heroes in Stonewall Jackson's famed Valley Campaign.
The Irish had a reputation for being the finest offensive soldiers in Lee's Army in Northern Virginia. So they were good. They were not fazed by artillery. They were good, reliable soldiers in combat, and the Irish again distinguished themselves throughout their existence.
Now near a small Pennsylvania town, Irish on both sides would again meet in a great battle. Lee's army was not prepared for a full battle. He had not wished to fight at this time or place. Ewell's corps was spread out to the north and east of Gettysburg, and Longstreet's men were almost a day's march behind. But when initial contact was made in the rolling country north of Gettysburg, General A.P. Hill would not pull back and ignored Lee's wishes to avoid a serious encounter. Quickly, the confrontation snowballed. Within hours, the two armies were locked in a major fight as more and more units were sucked into the growing fury of the struggle. The Civil War's greatest battle had begun, and Irish troops would play a role almost immediately. Brigadier General Harry Hayes commanded five regiments of heavily Irish Louisianans as part of Ewell's Corps. Hayes was a Tennessee-born New Orleans lawyer who had already won fame with these men.
Hayes' brigade was one of the very illustrious units in the Army of Northern Virginia. It had a distinguished record throughout its existence. And like Nichols' brigade, it had a reputation for fierceness, ability to perform under the most adverse conditions, and were extremely effective as offensive shock troops.
When the battle started, Hayes' Irishmen were some 14 miles north and east of Gettysburg on their way to York. With a forced march, the Irish arrived on the battlefield with the rest of their division at mid-afternoon, just in time to slam into the Federal right. The ferocious Tigers lived up to their fearsome reputation. One of General Ewell's men described the attack.
Then came one of the most warlike and animated spectacles I ever looked on. Gordon and Hayes charged across the plateau in their front at the double quick, sweeping everything before him and scattering the extreme right of the enemy.
The Union line collapsed and fell back through the streets of Gettysburg. Hayes' Tigers captured some 1,500 prisoners while losing only 63 men. The retreat on this part of the Union line didn't stop until General Howard's men had pulled back onto two heights south of town, known as Cemetery and Culp's Hills. The Irishman's blood was up. They and the rest of Early's men didn't want to stop their pursuit of the Yankees and were ready to climb the slopes of both hills, which were still only moderately defended. Both generals, Hayes and Early, were eager to be allowed to continue the attack before Cemetery Hill could be better fortified. But Ewell did not like the look of the Union position, and darkness was coming on. When Hayes persisted, General Ewell turned to the Louisianan and asked if his Irish Tigers never got a bellyful of fighting. It has been said that Ewell could have ended the battle had he continued the attack on Culp's and Cemetery Hills. Historians can only speculate. As night fell on this first day of battle, Patrick Kelly's Irish Brigade collapsed in a field 3 miles south of Gettysburg. Like most of Meade's army, the Irish had been rushed forward from Maryland once it became clear a major battle was underway to the north. Meade had survived near total defeat on this day through luck and the disciplined retreat of his men. On the other side, the Army of Northern Virginia had fought well and carried the day, but the total victory, which had seemed so close, had eluded it. The Union right was still well anchored, and most of Meade's army was, by evening, on or near the battlefield. Robert E. Lee would have no choice but to fight again tomorrow in this battle he had not wanted. The breaking dawn of July the 2nd found the men of Patrick Kelly's Irish Brigade already on the road.
It was about 6 or 7 o'clock in the morning. The Confederates were behind us here, over along the tree line there in the distance, along Seminary Ridge. The Irishmen had some time to think about what was going to happen. The fighting actually didn't begin until later in the afternoon.
Hour after hour on the morning of the battle's second day, the men of the Irish Brigade stared across empty fields and waited. It was hot. The tension was palpable. Every man knew a terrible fight would come before the blistering sun had set. Father William Corby, chaplain of the Irish Brigade, had been unable to hold religious services for some time. Now he could feel the anxiety of the men around him and sense that many would likely not live out this day.
So he went to Colonel Patrick Kelly and he asked him permission to address the men. Father Corby stood on a large rock in front of the Irish Brigade, and he explained to the Irishmen what he was about to do.
He told them that he was going to give them a general absolution, and he did so in Latin, and after he had done that, he said, "Now, I will absolve you from your sins, but let me remind you that if you are not truly sorry for them, it doesn't stick. In other words, you must be sorry for them." And so all of the Irish at that point were on their knees and said the act of contrition out loud. And all of the Protestant soldiers removed their hats, kneeled on the ground, and waited until the prayer was over.
Major St. Clair Mulholland, one of Kelly's brigade commanders, said of the scene,
"A distinct crackle of musketry rose and swelled and re-echoed through the woods, making music more sublime than ever sounded through cathedral aisles. The scene was more than impressive. It was awe-inspiring."
The Irishmen were not the only ones feeling the tension of the day. By afternoon, General Daniel Sickles, commander of the Third Corps on the left, believed that his position could not be well defended. He pushed his corps almost half a mile forward from the rest of the Union line, leaving a gaping hole in the Federal left. Longstreet's men immediately began their attack with Sickles as their target. The Union Third Corps was quickly in serious trouble. The battle on the southern part of the field quickly raged in several locations. The men of General Hood's division attacked Big and Little Round Top and swept through the woods of a local farmer, driving back Federal troops to the edge of a wheat field. The Federals hung on for a while, then fell back. Sickles' line was collapsing. If the Confederates could push through this section of the line, the rest of the Union Army would be in grave danger as well. Recognizing the threat of the situation, General Hancock ordered the 1st Division with the Irish Brigade to move from their positions on Cemetery Ridge and go quickly to Sickles' aid.
The Irish Brigade would continue down Cemetery Ridge. Through these open fields, they would go through the buildings of the George Weikert farm and continue down Cemetery Ridge, where they would report to a staff officer of General Sykes on their way to the wheat field.
Just east of Sickles' position, about 20 acres of ripe wheat nodded in the hot sun, ready for harvest. This harvest would never happen.
When they got to about where we are in the wheat field right now, the Irish Brigade looked ahead towards the Stony Hill, and they could see the Confederates from the 3rd and 7th South Carolina. Kershaw could also see the Irish Brigade as they advanced to about where we are, and he had the men changed the direction that they were facing to face the wheat field, to face the Irish Brigade.
The Irish Brigade that moved forward was a shadow of the unit which had won fame at Antietam and Fredericksburg. The entire brigade now numbered only 535. But they would show the whole army the proper way to face death under their brilliant emerald green banner with the golden harp of Mother Ireland.
They came charging through the wheat field, and then when they got to about where we are, they received their first volley. The Confederates were up ahead of us on Stony Hill. Now, there were woods here, but not as dense as you see today. The Confederates fired over the heads of the Irish Brigade. The Irish Brigade returned their volley. They charged forward, shouting their battle cry, "Fall of Allah," which in English translates to "clear the way."
In spite of moving uphill and over rough ground, the Irish poured a murderous fire into the Confederates.
The Irish Brigade is armed with would be a substandard weapon. They're armed with caliber 69, smoothbore muskets, the weapon the United States used in the Mexican War until 1842. While most soldiers now are armed with rifled muskets, but that smoothbore musket, once you get close, that 69 caliber ball and those 3/4-inch buckshot become very, very deadly.
Stumbling over logs and rocks, the Irish pushed the South Carolinians back until at last Stony Hill was again in Union hands.
The small, understrength Irish Brigade, by desperate fighting, had accomplished their mission. But then, disaster is in the offing.
Sickles had left the field after a cannonball took off his leg. For all their great effort, the Irish and their fellow brigades were now lacking overall leadership and had fought themselves into a trap.
As Major Mulholland and Colonel Kelly look to the right, they can see advancing rapidly eastward Wofford's Georgians. Now, with the advance of Wofford, the Irish are forced off Stony Hill, back across the wheat field, that maelstrom of death, and backward toward Cemetery Ridge as the Confederates surge forward.
In one of the ironies of this cruel war, Wofford's 24th Georgians, who now poured fire into the departing Irish Brigade, were also largely Irish. They too had left the famine of the old country to find salvation in America. It is likely many were from the same counties and villages as the Irish in blue. A Union officer looked down at the pounding the retreating Federals were taking and said, "What a hell is down in that valley." Hell is surely what it was, as the Irish and the other men in blue now took deadly fire from three sides.
As the Irish Brigade retreated through the wheat field, Wofford's men had come sweeping down the wheat field road, slamming into their right flank. Kershaw's men would push them from the front, and G.T. Anderson's men from their left. When they retreated through the wheat field, they were practically running a gauntlet of death.
530 men of the Irish Brigade had proudly charged through the wheat field. 200 would not return. The fight here had lasted little over an hour. 5,000 to 6,000 men of the Irish Brigade and the other units lay around the wheat field.
After Gettysburg, after the wheat field, actually, the brigade was never as Irish. It was never as ferocious as it had been. And it was never able to maintain its independence as a unit the way it had been before.
Darkness was falling as the men of the 1st Division stumbled back to the spot they had left on Cemetery Ridge only a short time before. This day was at last ending for the Irish Brigade, and with it, their contribution to the Battle of Gettysburg. One of the Civil War's most legendary fighting units would never be the same. As As the Irish Brigade was enduring such terrible losses in the wheat field, the Confederate Irish of Ewell's Corps were again moving into battle on the extreme right flank of the Union line. Lee had told Ewell that if he thought he stood a chance of succeeding, he should make a full-scale assault on Culp's and Cemetery Hill. Yesterday, such orders would have helped a timid Ewell take advantage of a good situation. Today, they would only encourage Ewell to gamble on a bad one. The extra day had given the Federals time to prepare a defense. The Union commander at the top of Culp's Hill was 62-year-old George Green, a Rhode Islander and the oldest Federal on the field. Green was a civil engineer and believed in the value of fortifications. All during the second day, he had his men cutting trees and building stout breastworks across the crest of Culp's Hill. Over on Cemetery Hill, the Confederates could hear the rattle of more artillery being moved into place. The delay in attacking the Union right last night meant the Southerners would today face an awesome reception from these heights. Ewell's plan had Irish involved in both phases of the attack. The Irishmen of Hayes' Louisiana Brigade would be part of the attack on Cemetery Hill. The assault on Culp's Hill would be handled by three brigades, including Nichols, which had many Irish on its roster. These were more Louisiana regiments commanded by men with names like O'Rourke and Dolan, Monahan and Shaw. Some companies were 90% Irish. It wasn't until 4 o'clock that Longstreet's cannon fire to the south told Ewell it was time to make his move and Confederate artillery opened up. But after the guns had stopped, it was almost 6:30 before the various Confederate units could be coordinated to begin the assault.
The mission of Nichols Brigade, if you look over in this area, their job was to cross Rock Creek and move up directly up that very steep, boulder-strewn slope and dislodge the Union forces at the crest of Culp's Hill.
The day was nearly over by the time the Irish moved forward. Yelling like wild men, they began the difficult climb up Culp's Hill.
We're right near the crest of Culp's Hill, and I just want to show you what the Irish of Nichols' brigade and also the brigade to their right, Jones's brigade, were up against. As you can see, the entire slope, good bit of slope, is rock-strewn, very difficult. They're moving at night. There's a jumble of downed trees and limbs, and they're trying to make their way through it as they attack up towards the breastworks, which were prepared by men in Green's, General Green's Union Brigade. From the base of Culp's Hill and from a distance on the other side of Rock Creek, Culp's Hill doesn't look like much of an obstacle. It's only when you get up close that you realize what a difficult climb this was for any attacking force.
Although some of the Union line was taken on the extreme Confederate left, the bravery of the Southerners could not make up for the devastating fire the Northerners now poured down from behind their breastworks. The Irishmen of Nichols' brigade fell back through the darkness and at last moved back down Culp's Hill. As the battle for Culp's Hill had raged, the other Irish Louisianans under General Hayes were ready to begin their assault on the equally daunting Cemetery Hill. Cemetery Hill was much less steep than Culp's and didn't have trees or rocks. What it did have was a lot of Union cannon. But if the Confederates could somehow take Cemetery Hill, they would be standing on the Federal right flank, looking unopposed down the length of the Union Army on Cemetery Ridge. The men of Harry Hayes' brigade began their attack.
Raised in New Orleans, 8 of its 10 companies from Ireland, 2 of its companies German. They had been a part of the Louisiana Brigade that had followed Stonewall in the valley. They'd seen hard action on day one. On July 2nd, as darkness begins to fall, the Louisiana Brigade surges forward.
Now, their objective on the night of, at dusk of 2 July, was to take East Cemetery Hill off to my right. And all this time, they're out here moving through this open field as it closed in on East Cemetery Hill. They're under very, very heavy artillery fire, which didn't faze them.
With the federal guns at the top of the hill ripping great gaps in their lines with point-blank grapeshot, the Irish came on. With furious determination, they routed the line of Union infantry that stood in its path. At last, they struggled to the top of Cemetery Hill.
They swung out in this direction and came in like this directly on East Cemetery Hill. They routed the Union forces at the base of the hill, not all of them, but they broke through and continued all the way up right here to the top.
Civil War artillerymen generally did not carry sidearms. In the fading light, the frantic Union gunners defended themselves with gun swabs, fence rails, and even rocks. But they could not match the fierce rage of Hayes Irish and their North Carolina brothers. Against all odds, for one brief moment, the Confederates held Cemetery Hill and perhaps the outcome of the Battle of Gettysburg in their hands.
Then, just as it seems, the Southerners might have prevailed. Union reinforcements arrive. No Confederate reinforcements. Darkness closes in. Too late. Union reinforcements open fire. And slowly but surely, the 6th Louisiana and their comrades are forced back. And we have one of the great might-have-beens of the Battle of Gettysburg, which makes it such an intensely interesting battle to discuss.
As Hayes' men were forced back past their dead who had fought so valiantly, any hope of a total Confederate victory in this battle probably retreated with them.
Cemetery Hill was the key to the battlefield at Gettysburg. I mean, a lot of people think Little Round Top was, but Cemetery Hill was the key position. He who held Cemetery Hill controlled the battlefield. So if they'd been able to take that hill and hold on to the hill, the Union Army would have had to readjust their position or retreat from the battlefield.
But Meade and his army would make no retreat at the end of this day. They would be waiting for Robert E. Lee in the morning. July 3rd, 1863, the third day of battle. Having tried without success to turn both ends of the Federal line, Robert E. Lee would now try the center. Pickett's division from Longstreet's Corps and two divisions from Hill's Corps would make the attack and hit the center of the Union line on Cemetery Ridge. Waiting for them was another unit of Union Irish.
The Army of the Potomac had many Irish throughout the entire Army, and they had a number of other units that were largely Irish, and some of those were in the thick of the fighting at critical points. But one of the ones that saw some of the hardest fighting was the 69th Pennsylvania. And the reason was they were posted in front of the clump of trees on July 3rd, and the clump of trees was used by the Confederates in Pickett's charge as a terrain feature to guide the attack.
The 69th Pennsylvania was a regiment recruited mostly from Philadelphia Irish. Its members had come over in the 1840s and 50s during the worst of the famine. The morning had been still as if the small valley was resting before the coming fury. But at 1 o'clock, the quiet was broken when 150 of Lee's guns began the greatest bombardment in the history of North America.
This cannonade would last for about 2 hours as the Union forces fired 90 cannons back. And as the smoke cleared around 3 o'clock in the afternoon after this two-hour cannonade, the Irish Brigade could look across these open fields to the distant tree line, and they would see 12 to 13,000 Confederates emerging out of those woods, marching shoulder to shoulder. The line would eventually be about a mile and a quarter long.
This was the sort of thing you didn't see in the Civil War. Even though people think you did, you never saw that many soldiers. And if you were an infantryman in the 69th, this was more Johnny Rebs than you ever wanted to see. This was a belly full of them. And they're coming right at you. And they were coming with beautiful discipline.
Even as Union artillery slashed great gaps in the ranks, the men of Virginia, Mississippi, and North Carolina moved forward in perfect alignment, ever closer to the waiting enemy.
A soldier in the 69th said, once the Confederates got through the fences and the farm, they came in a rush. So now the men are moving as quickly as they possibly can. They're not running. They're moving at a discipline, what the Army would call a double quick step or quick time. And it's like a big gray wave rolling up towards your position.
The Irish held their fire until the attackers were little more than 50 yards away. Then they let loose.
Confederate soldiers who were struck by that first volley from the 69th would have been right in this area where we're standing here. They were soldiers from Garnett's Brigade and Pickett's Division. They were Virginians. A soldier in the 69th wrote a letter after the war to a historian of the battle and described this volley. And he wrote one sentence. He said, the slaughter was terrible.
The Confederates were being decimated, but some 200 Virginians managed to get over the wall only a few yards to the north of the Irish. Now these Confederates were behind the Irish. It was the Southerners' turn to inflict damage. Company F of the 69th was wiped out in moments. The next company in line was Company B, commanded by Captain Patrick Tinnan.
Pat Tinnan, before the war, was a paper hanger, a machinist, and a bartender. And Pat Tinnan pulled his men back from the wall and took on these Confederate soldiers right here, right in this spot, in the only hand-to-hand fighting that I have ever found in Pickett's Charge. And soldiers were firing at point-blank range. One soldier crushed the skull of a Confederate and had his skull crushed in turn by that Confederate soldier's comrade. That was the nature of the fight. And one of the soldiers of the 69th would say that what Pat Tinnan and his company did here saved the regiment from being overrun and captured by the Confederates.
And they will throw back the Confederates. And the great charge has been repulsed. And instrumental in turning back the Confederates is the 69th Pennsylvania.
Over 12,000 men had left the trees of Seminary Ridge less than an hour before. Half of those men did not return. It was an awesome spectacle in a war filled with spectacle. Never before or after did Robert E. Lee suffer such a complete defeat. July 4th was the 87th birthday of the Republic. All day, the two exhausted armies stared at each other across the corpse-ridden fields. The following day, Robert E. Lee would start his army on the long road of retreat toward the south bank of the Potomac. His great invasion of the North was over. The contributions of the Irish soldier to the Union cause would continue, but never in quite the dramatic fashion achieved during the war's first years.
It's after Gettysburg that the Irish Brigade is consolidated into other units. In other words, basically broken up for about 6 months in 1864. They bring it back again, but it's only a shadow of what it had been.
After the Battle of Gettysburg, that's when the draft system was instituted, and a lot of the recruits went into the Irish Brigade, were not of Irish origin.
But the brigade that did remain continued to fight until the end of the war. Patrick Kelly, who led the Irish Brigade through the awful trial of the wheat field, was killed by a bullet to the head in 1864 at the Battle for Petersburg. The Irish of the South also continued their role in Lee's army. The Louisiana Irish, who tried so hard to push the Union troops off Culps and Cemetery Hill, fought for the Confederacy to the last possible moment. On an April day in Western Virginia, the Irish Tigers raised the sound of the rebel yell for the final time and charged a Federal position. But they were ordered back to their lines and told the sad news that Robert E. Lee had just surrendered in Wilmer McLean's parlor. For some of the Irish who had served in the Civil War, there remained the dream of returning to Ireland. But most Irish who had fought so hard in this agonizing war wanted no part of the old country. They longed for the same thing every other soldier longed for after Appomattox, to return to their homes and families and go about rebuilding their dreams in a future free from war.
All these ethnic groups wanted to be an American first. They didn't want to dwell upon their ethnic background, even though they were proud of it, because the 69th carried an Irish flag, which tells me that they were very proud of being Irish, but they were Americans first.
They were wild and they were crazy. They drank heavily, they fought heavily, they didn't care what people thought, and they were very good soldiers. They look back and they say, wow, you know, look at these guys, they were unbelievable. But if you think about it, what did they have to lose? Nothing. They had nothing to lose and everything to gain. They wanted to do it right, and they did. They captured people's imagination.
Their courage and valor would forever be the stuff of legend. America's Irish had added their own special chapter to the story of the nation's most tragic war.